When you think of a community leader, what comes to mind? They can be anyone, from barbers to nurses, you name it. Local Trailblazers are all around us. Their initiatives are different, but ultimately, they share the same goal, making the world a better place. Thanks for joining us. I'm Destiny Chance. In this episode, we'll show you some of our favorite everyday heroes, and some of them may be in your hometown. Our first batch of stories show us how activism can change the world. These first Trailblazers actually don't need an introduction. Actor Kevin Bacon and his brother Michael Bacon spend their free time helping local communities. In Maryland, WBAL-TV reporter Kyrie Stewart caught up with them as they helped save the environment.
It should be that now all these problems are solved, and they're not.
When Kevin and Michael Bacon aren't on stage or working on a film, you can sometimes catch them helping out in different communities. They rolled up their sleeves for a stream restoration project at Broad Creek Park in Annapolis.
We're planting small flowers and bushes that are helping to essentially slow down the onslaught of what's happening in people's lawns and farms and rushing into the bay.
Their foundation called 6degrees.org focuses on youth empowerment, sustainability, and emerging issues. They joined forces with the Arundel Rivers Federation, and local scouts showed up to help as well. Matthew Johnston is the executive director of the Arundel Rivers Federation. He says they do dozens of these restoration projects to transform degraded streams that could send sediment down to the Chesapeake Bay. Along with helping to keep the water clean, the Bacon brothers say that there's so much more that these young people can learn.
They're learning about frogs and toads and what they do. They're learning about the keeping the bay clean, about the food that they get from it.
And they think this will also help them realize the impact that their work will have on the environment.
I mean, they're making the connections for these kids, and so that when they actually go and put their hands in the dirt, they understand that they're doing much more than just planting a little flower.
They said that this is a step in the right direction, and they hope this shows people how important it is to help keep our environment clean.
And I know the bay's gotten much better, but there's still a long way to go.
The Bacon brothers are saving the environment and inspiring others to make a difference. In Alabama, one couple is helping an entire community one seed at a time. Here's WVTM reporter Brittany Decker with a story.
Did you ever think it would turn into this?
Yeah, I did.
What started as a small front yard garden for Christopher Gooden and his wife Dominique has now blossomed into Fountain Heights Community Farms.
We've got tomatoes, onions. I've got some watermelons down there in the center. We've got some eggplants growing. Melons down there.
Moving to the Fountain Heights neighborhood in 2017, their initial goal was to save a buck or two.
We started growing our own food as a way to save money.
But they soon started sharing their produce with neighbors.
A lot of folks, a lot of elders that we notice here that are having to walk to go to grocery store.
This one right here is called Soko Kyoto. It's a Nigerian spinach.
And connections sparked into deeper conversation.
The average income in this area, I believe, is about $13,000.
The couple quickly noticing the need for affordable fresh food.
Year before the pandemic, we produced about 30,000 pounds of produce. And just to know that we put all of that in the freestand and it all went out, there's a clear demand for more.
Encouraged by this, they expanded, transforming a vacant lot next door that Christopher would mow into a vibrant urban farm.
First year I had 8 rows and I had 21, and then we had the greenhouse.
And now they have 5 lots in Fountain Heights, a neighborhood classified in 2020 as the most dangerous in Birmingham and an area filled with history.
A lot of people don't realize that a lot of the terrorism from the civil rights era was in this area, like right across the street. So it's an area that's really been just kind of forgotten about.
The couple wants it now to be known for community pride in the land, which leads to their current mission that goes beyond creating food, but also growing farmers.
We're also going to start a program where we try to get people to not be as scared of urban farming and teach them how to farm and work on how they can acquire land, like in a neighborhood like this.
Bearing fruits beyond the Goodens' own needs, spreading good, and beautifying their community, with hopes their efforts will continue to spread like wildflowers and gain attention and support.
Make sure we have flowers growing and the bees buzzing, and you know, people can go by and say, like, hey, you know, yeah, I live in Fountain Heights by the farm. Yep. You know, it becomes a landmark.
A beautiful garden and a beautiful initiative. Our next couple is taking their goodwill on the road. WAPT reporter Cecil Hannibal tells us how they're volunteering across the country.
We are here in Pensacola, Florida, and
for one couple, helping isn't a choice. It's a lifestyle.
We are headed to volunteer.
And it might sound unconventional.
The initial reaction was, are you all nuts?
But Shauna and Tony Hayes are crazy about volunteering. So much, in fact, they've made a very big commitment.
We jumped up, we sold everything we own, we cleared our house, we put our house for sale.
With remote jobs and their kids out of the nest, the two left Houston in this tricked-out RV.
Welcome to our home on wheels!
To see the country, but not just to sightsee.
We travel around the United States. We live in each city for a month at a time, and all we do is volunteer somewhere every day.
From Pensacola, Florida, all the way to Memphis, Tennessee, combined, they've put in over 100 hours a month at various nonprofits. Their latest stop is right here in the capital city, volunteering at places like We Will Go Ministries, Stew Pot, and more.
This is a mission and a journey that we feel so strongly that God has led us to, and we are going to be obedient.
This marriage on a mission is driven by a desire to help people who are at their lowest.
I'm the luckiest guy in the world.
You may see Tony smiling ear to ear now, but before he met Shauna, the Army veteran suffered from PTSD and depression after serving in Operation Desert Storm. He says it was their union, faith, and service that saved him.
I thought I was hurting. There are hurting people out here. So just by being willing to say yes along with my wife, man, I could see that I've been blessed the whole time. No matter what you think you have or don't have, just be willing to help.
The Hayes hope their story will inspire others to get involved in their own community. Tony and Shauna say you don't have to drive across the country to make an impact. They say just give a little of your time to an organization near you, even if it's up the street. With good intentions, good deeds can go far.
Tony and Shauna are making the world a better place, one state at a time. After the break, we'll bring you stories of community members making it their mission to empower others. Welcome back. We return with stories of pioneers uplifting their communities. In Omaha, Nebraska, local barbers recognize the need for more mental health resources and are learning to become advocates. KETV reporter Quanicia Fraser has the story.
Like, I won't have to
from clippers to conversation.
Because if it was me, I'm like, what made you think that that was cool?
The mental aspect of it, for me, is a huge part of even the barbering industry in itself.
Daniel Goodwin knows the styling chair can be a safe place for a lot of his clients.
No. It's a safe space. It's a space where a lot of men feel more vulnerable and in a trustworthy environment where they're willing to share and communicate.
Goodwin learned how to take that to another level by getting trained to be a mental health advocate.
It's been something that's been heavily on people's minds, especially men, especially black men.
That's part of the reason why the Well-Being Partners created a program called Head to Heart.
The program was developed as a result of the Community Health Needs Assessment, which is a metro area-wide health assessment that the Regional Health Council conducts and publishes. When we look at that Community Health Needs Assessment data from 2018 to 2021, we saw almost a 5% reduction in the number of people who reported that they had someone to go to at times of need or when they needed help.
Asia Anderson says those numbers were even higher among Black, Hispanic, and low-income populations. She hopes the Head to Heart program can make a difference.
Our participants are going to get trained and certified in mental health first aid so that they're able to recognize the signs of mental health conditions. We're going to train them on resources as well and strategies and techniques to use as their clients are in their chair.
Goodwin believes this program will reduce the stigma surrounding mental health in the Black community through both styling and support.
This initiative shows that support can be found anywhere. In Boston, reporter Erica Tarantell meets a group of Trailblazers that uplift women of color one step at a time.
You know what time it is. It's time to trailblaze!
It's to be part of a sisterhood that uplifts women in running, but also in other aspects of their being is incredibly powerful.
Alia Katarna has been running since she was in high school, but this part of her journey isn't about the distance.
I am a leader for Trailblazers, and that's L-E-A-D-H-E-R, lead her.
One extra letter changing the whole meaning of those words and opening the door to create a space for women and especially women of color.
We hear women say, well, I'm not a runner. If you run for the 39 bus, you are a runner.
Any newbies today?
Clap it up for Jessica.
On this day, Alia and her co-leader Lindsay Thorne Bingham are guiding the running group through what they call Self-Care Sunday. It's a monthly event responding to a need for more than fitness.
We have heard women say that they've had, you know, they're going through hard times, and just having a dedicated space where they can, yes, run and feel good, but also talk and be in community with one another.
I really believe that I am a better me because of Trailblazers. I am a better me physically, mentally, emotionally, spiritually, because of what is here.
Lindsay says part of her journey with the Trailblazers is about breaking the running mold and helping other women do the same.
There is this notion in the larger runner community that you have to have a certain body, a certain physique, a certain look, and that's not true. We are here because we are runners. Everybody is a runner, and we all look different. And so I can show up authentically as my Black self in this space and disrupt the running community. We truly believe that, you know, you should be here.
The group actually started in 2020.
Social injustice, COVID, and Trailblazers sort of sprung to action during that time, just to create a space where people can be in solidarity with each other.
The solidarity and joy are on full display, and both women have a final message.
Come out, join us. Whether you are starting walking and you're scared to walk, we'll walk with you.
We like to say that people come for the miles and stay for the community.
A great way to find strength within yourself and among your community. I know that's right. Speaking of Trailblazers, one woman founded a nonprofit in Pittsburgh to help people in poverty become homeowners. Here's WTAE's Michelle Wright with the story.
Pittsburgh, the city of champions. But apparently not for everyone. A report came out a few years ago by the Gender Equity Commission that showed Black women in Pittsburgh could improve their lives by moving to any other city.
What it basically stated is that Black women could do better living anywhere else in this country besides Pittsburgh.
We're the worst?
We are the worst. We are at the very bottom, and literally it said that we would do better living anywhere else.
That's shocking.
It was very shocking.
That sparked Tammy Thompson into action. She founded a nonprofit called Catapult Greater Pittsburgh to help people in poverty, especially Black single mothers, to learn to become entrepreneurs and become homeowners. Since she founded the group, she's helped more than 100 people buy their first home. Catapult can offer as much as $5,000 for closing costs and is also working on a new program with Pittsburgh Housing Finance Agency to offer up to $25,000 for a down payment.
We see people come through these doors who they never would have thought that homeownership was an option for them, right? Because they didn't see it, right? Their families weren't homeowners, their neighbors weren't homeowners, and they come here and they realize this is for me. Like, I do have the opportunity to do this.
And the impact is generational.
It is the opportunity to pass things along to generations that are coming behind you. And so black people in this city, historically, in terms of just the statistics, we have not been able to amass the same types of generational wealth as maybe our white counterparts. And so for people to be able to pass something along to their children, to their grandchildren, that changes the trajectory of a whole entire family.
These incredible women took on a glaring issue and found solutions that can impact generations to come. After the break, we're showing you advocates who are providing people hope and second chances. Welcome back. We're now showing you incredible folks who give second chances to those in need. We're first taking you to Boston, where one nurse is making it his mission to save lives outside of the hospital. Here's a story from WCVB's Jessica Brown.
Anthony Gray is in the middle of his 12-hour shift as an ER nurse at Brigham and Women's Faulkner Hospital.
If someone is having an unstable problem, as a nurse, you're in a position to change their life. Your interaction with the patient, whether it's treating their injury or providing them with a cup of water, your empathy or showing them compassion goes a long way. That's why I chose nursing. That's why I love nursing.
He's been a nurse now for 14 years. However, Anthony says medicine hasn't always been his dream.
Nursing just kind of fell into my lap. I was an EMT prior to becoming a registered nurse, and I never thought about education coming up. It was just mainly just living my life. I never thought about what I'd become.
To understand that, you have to go back to Miami, where Anthony grew up, in a neighborhood called Overtown, a once thriving area that fell into poverty. By the time Anthony was a teen, he became a drug dealer. He says it wasn't until after he did time behind bars that he started to turn things around.
What changed?
God. It had to be God and my grandmother. My grandmother played a major role. My grandmother always gave me the history of African Americans in this country.
His grandmother, a nurse in Georgia, became his guide. Anthony, following in her footsteps, graduating from nursing school at the age of 24.
I'm proud of myself. I'm proud that I stuck with it. I'm proud of all them nights that I had studied. I'm proud of all them nights that I just pushed myself and drove myself to just do something better in life and just be a role model to young men who come from environments that I come from.
Now Anthony's mission goes beyond the ER, his goal to be part of the solution in reducing gun violence. Anthony was awarded the Ralph F. Brown Jr. Award at the Juneteenth Emancipation Observance in the city of Boston for his work as a leader, building positive futures for kids in the community. For Anthony, he says it's all about the next generation.
Creating change, I want to focus on that and just change my environment, change the concept of being somebody in life.
Anthony shows us there's no limit to helping others. Up next in Baltimore, WBAL-TV reporter Brianna Ross introduces us to a veteran who found a new source of hope by gardening.
It's hard to believe that this was once an abandoned lot full of trash. Now it's a place where people can learn how to grow fresh produce. And for the man who keeps it all up, it's a source of hope and purpose.
In this farm along Cumberland Street, you'll find lots of green space, veggies, and herbs. But what Cy Sneed has found in this farm is much deeper than what meets the eye.
It was a way for me to get out of my troubles and kind of like bring me back, you know. Tying into God, tying into myself, becoming one with the earth again.
Sneed spent summers farming in North Carolina as a child, but after serving in the Army and losing his sister, life got him down. He joined the VA's farm program to get back on his feet and back to his roots.
A lot of the veterans in the program come from a background of farming or gardening, and so it just feels right to get back into that, and then it gives them a sense of purpose.
Not only are they going in and getting a skill, but they're also eating better, definitely exercising on the farm.
Sneed took what he learned from the program to his own neighborhood, turned what was once a dead space full of needles, debris, and trash into a space that's full of life.
Thought it would be a good idea to try to clean it up and drop a seed in it and see what happened, and this is what it grew to.
Cy reminds us of the benefits of going back to your roots. Our final community champion takes us to Portland, Maine, where one man is providing second chances of hope for those in need. WMTW reporter Jim Keithley has the story.
Probably the most favorite item is probably the hot chocolate. Having something warm to put your hands around, you know?
The sun wasn't even up on this early morning, but Matt Brown was checking his inventory. The back of his Prius was packed.
We've got some, you know, small food items, but we also put notes in them. You know, we're trying to send folks the message that they do matter, because that's not the feeling that they have when they're out here. They don't feel like they're seen or heard or that they matter. So that's probably the most important part of this.
Each Friday, Matt hits the road visiting homeless encampments, trying to provide nourishment and compassion along the way. First stop, Deering Oaks Park, to check on someone who spends the night under a tarp.
But just our presence, you know, a compassionate presence goes a really long way. So that's what it's, at the end of the day, that's what it's all about. We're losing so many people to fentanyl overdoses and you name it. I work part-time at a funeral home. I have to pick people up that die of overdoses. You know, the urgency is on my mind all the time. But I think what's really killing people is despair, hopelessness, discouragement.
They visit the homeless encampments that are deep in the woods, too. He calls it Hope Squad Maine. He's even purchased an old ambulance that's being retrofitted to make his mission easier.
I had this concept of having an ambulance because of the way it sticks out, you know, but also has room to actually talk to people, to be able to go around and connect with people.
And he's not dropping off much appreciated items. Matt Brown is a peer support worker for the Spurwink Crisis Center in Bayside. His job is to connect with people when they first come through the doors. One man recently came off the streets freezing cold.
Talking to him about, can I get you a tent? Can I get you a sleeping bag? No. Can I get you a sandwich? Can I get you a drink? He's like, no. And I said, what? And he says, to tell you the truth, just being in here and having a conversation, it's reminded me for a moment that I'm human, because I forget, and that I matter to somebody. That's why we're doing it.
He doesn't have all the answers, but has a lot of societal questions.
We've got how many church buildings in this city and that have heated buildings that are sitting there, and we have all these people that are out here freezing in doorways. How about opening up some churches? You know, things like that. I don't know. I think until as a community we say this matters, it's not going to change.
All of these trailblazers created solutions to issues impacting their communities. We hope these stories prove that you can be the change you want to see in the world. I'm Destiny Chance. From all of us at Stitch, thank you for watching. See you next time.